Thank you so much. Magandang hapon po sa inyong lahat. It's actually so great to be back here in the GSIS Theater because in 1998, I believe, up to the year 2000, this theater was Ballet Manila's home for 3 full seasons. As part of course, of our mission of bringing ballet to the people and people to the ballet. I danced on this stage many times. And in fact, I think I brought my baby, my firstborn, Missy, on this stage while I was dancing Nutcracker. And backstage there in that dressing room, I was pumping in between acts. So I can never forget this theater, really. The title of my story is The Selfless Act of... Oh, sorry, The Beauty of the Selfless Act. It's actually quite ironic because I am a dancer and getting good at the art of dancing or ballet is actually a very selfish profession. Ballet actually is a very selfish profession. Why? Because as ballerinas, as dancers, we spend most of our time in the studio between ourselves and the mirror. And there are no vacations. There's no such thing as, stopping at 5 o'clock. No weekends. In fact, we work harder on the weekends. No social life because we perform at night normally. We have to sleep early because our bodies are our instruments for our art and we have to take care of it. Dancing is actually a very selfish profession and it demands so much from the dancer. It demands a lot. It demands, first and foremost, commitment. I was invited because I think someone in the committee loved the line that I shared in a speech 3 years ago in Ateneo as a part of the commencement speech. It was actually the 8th count in my 1-8 formula of advice or advice towards success, pointers towards success that I gave the graduating batch of Ateneo 3 years ago. The 8th count was to serve, that we should serve ourselves sometimes, but we serve others more often. That was my 8th count. Now, you may not know 1-7, so I'll just briefly go through it. Number 1 was you have to decide and commit. The first step really to anything is a decision. It comes from a decision. I decided that I wanted to become a professional ballet dancer when I was 14 years old. I had met Japanese prima ballerina Yoko Morishita. After meeting her, seeing that she was a tiny Asian Japanese prima ballerina, dancing such a regal, tall role of the white swan and the black swan in Swan Lake. Something, a role that I always thought was reserved only for foreigners, only for the European beauty that was blonde and blue-eyed and tall and with long lines. So I met her and I said, well, if this tiny Japanese prima ballerina can dance Swan Lake, then maybe I can too. And so I committed to that goal, is to become very, very good at classical ballet dancing. And really, I wanted to become a classical ballerina, not really a modern dancer. And be able to dance Swan Lake at least once. I've danced Odette Odile 57 times. It started with a commitment at 14. But of course, number 2 brings me to the number 2 pointer. It is to work hard and to always feel the pain, the extra pain of that extra effort. No pain, no gain. In our profession, stress fractures, sprains, strains, backache, knees, joints, all kinds of pain. I've gone through them all. If we stop, I always tell my students this, if you stop after the first sign of muscle pain, then you will never get stronger. So the pain is good. Of course, there's bad pain. There's bad pain when you get injured. That's another story. Number three is you have to get good at it. Whatever you do, whatever you're doing, you have to be extra good at it. Mediocrity or less than good doesn't really count. Why? Because if you want to teach and give back in the future, when you reach the point that you are able to serve others, you have to be good at what you're teaching. You have to know what you're mentoring and teaching. Number four is, you know, my heart is pounding right now. I think it's okay. It's quite good to be fearful, to be nervous, to go on stage and think that, ooh, I might make a mistake and it's going to be very embarrassing. Because that fear is very real. It's what makes us human. And conquering that fear and getting up after falling down. I've fallen down so many times while in my more than 32 years of dancing. And getting up after falling down is what makes the performance special. You learn from it, you grow from it. Ask any successful person and they will say that their success started with learning to fail. Number five, fifth count, is you have to be prepared. You have to prepare really well for anything. That means, in our profession, it means rehearsal, repetition. I'm in the studio from 4 to 6 hours a day. And it means standing in a turned out position for 4 hours in order to achieve that muscle memory and that line. It means repeating a step constantly, maybe adding one more turn. Instead of a double, we do a triple turn. Maybe adding a little bit more height in that leg, but it comes from constant repetition. Sometimes we don't have that time. In Cuba, I did number six, which is sometimes you have to take the risk. You have to do something really crazy. In Cuba in 1990, there was a knock on my door. The general manager of the International Ballet Festival there said, "Lisa, we lost our ballerina for Swan Lake in 4 days' time. Can you do it?" I was like, okay. I rehearsed, learned a completely different version, the Alicia Alonso version, in 4 days' time with a Spanish-speaking partner who did not speak a word of English. I did my Russian version for Act 3, and I learned all the other acts. I learned the Cuban choreography. It was the worst Swan Lake of my life. It was really bad. In fact, I was watching it. I have a videotape of it. And there were some good points, but overall, it was the worst Swan Lake of my life. But I did it. In 4 days, I went on stage and grabbed that opportunity. It was crazy. But it taught me that I can be a Swan Queen. You have to know that when I was in Russia and I graduated at the top of my class from the Russian Ballet Academy way back in 1984, my teacher said, "Lisa, you're ready to do any ballet in the classical ballet repertoire except Swan Lake." I'm like, "But Tatiana Alexandra, why not Swan Lake?" He said, "Well, Swan Lake, Odette Odile is just not you. You don't have the height, you don't have the look of a swan queen. Sometimes even the most respected and dearest of mentors can be wrong. Number seven, and I'm almost at number eight. Sometimes when you're doing what you do, doing what you love, working towards a goal, working towards your, you know, commitment, you also have to know when it may be time to stop, take a break, or walk away. Change your goals, change everything, decide and commit all over again, go back to step one. Because sometimes it's just not gonna work. I wanted to learn how to sing for the longest time. Pero parang ayaw sa akin ng kanta. But my sister is a professional musical actress, actually. Recently, I went back to my singing lessons. And in fact, at the last moment, had to take the place of the pink fairy in our production of Pinocchio and sang When You Wish Upon a Star. No. I promise to keep this short because the other speakers after me have an appointment after. So I will not make you suffer through that. But yes. You really have to know sometimes when you have to stop and turn around and maybe commit to a different goal. If it's not working, give yourself a deadline. I gave myself 2 years. My parents wanted me to become an accountant. So I said, give me 2 years just to devote to learning how to dance. And after those 2 years, if nothing happens, then I'll go back to school and become an accountant. Maybe not an accountant, a teacher. Which I am now. I'm a ballet teacher. And I really am so inspired by my students. You know, I was just the other day in our Fisher-Merle branch teaching the adult ballet. And I had a 70-year-old student in class. And she was doing everything, you know, she was moving. Suddenly, I forgot all the pain in my operated hip and all the different pains that I was feeling in my 52-year-old body. And I said, wow, ma'am, idol. And when I said, okay, everybody, point shoes. Aba, she started to put on point shoes. I was like, sigurado po ba kayo? But yes, she put on point shoes. And she did it. Okay. I have 3 more minutes. Yes. Okay. I want to tell you a story. It's about stories, yes? So, this story, not many people know about. It happened to me on an airplane coming home from Singapore. I had danced with the Singapore Dance Theater as a guest artist. I was in Singapore for 9 days. I did 3 performances in the Victoria Theater. I was coming back to Manila, and I sat down in my seat, and beside me was a domestic helper, and there was a man to my right and to my left. And when it was time for writing the information on the immigration card, this woman was like very, very hesitant. And so I was like writing my, you know, my information. And then so she was like, ilang taon ka sa Singapore? And I was like, 9 days. She's like, bakit broken contract? And then sabi ko, hindi po, talagang 9 days lang talaga yung bisita ko doon. Sabi niya, di ko kasi alam kung anong ilalagay ko sa profession. Ano ba yung linagay mo? Sabi ko, performing artist. Aha, talaga? Pwede ba yun? Sabi ko, ilagay mo na lang domestic helper, okay lang. Hindi ba nakakahiya? Sabi ko, hindi, hindi, okay lang. And then the man who was seated on my right, obviously, who was listening in on our conversation, went, ilagay mo ng DH, okay lang yan, buti nga hindi dancer. Why did I tell that story? Because as a dancer, I now have my pet project, which is Project Ballet Futures. And one of my top graduates and a student that I'm so very proud of in Project Ballet Futures is celebrating her 19th birthday this month, very soon, Jessa Balote. She was, at the age of 10, given a scholarship as part of Project Ballet Futures. From when she was very, very small and was walking, in fact, the mother says, the mother of Jessa says, kaya matigas ang mga tuhod niyan kasi bata pa lang yan, umaakyat na yan sa bundok ng Smoky Mountain. You know, she was a scavenger. She was going up Smoky Mountain and looking for plastics and cans and bottles to recycle, to pay for their food, you know, to eat every day. At the age of 10, she started ballet. At the age of 14, she competed in the Asian Grand Prix as a finalist. At the age of 16, she performed her pas de deux, Le Corsaire pas de deux. She portrayed a princess in a diamond tiara on stage. And at 17, she was a fully contracted artist in Ballet Manila and is the breadwinner of their family. And I just learned recently that their family has been able to make a down payment in a house in Antipolo, government housing, at 200 pesos a month, and they now have a house in Antipolo. Jessa Balote is just one example of how Project Ballet Futures has made a difference in the lives of children. Not everyone that starts ballet lessons or dance lessons becomes a professional dancer. But if there's one thing that I learned as a dancer is the value of hard work, the value of sweat, the discipline of keeping a routine and sticking to something until you are damn good at it. And now as a teacher, I've learned that it is an extremely joyful and rewarding experience to pass on what I know to the next generation of Filipinos. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Lisa. Yes. Ma'am, to keep you warmer, may we invite you back on stage because the light keeps us warm.
Yes.
And we'd like to call on the stage Dr. Bukoy to give you our plaque of appreciation. Thank you very much. Again, everyone, again, let's please give a warm round of applause to Lisa Macuja, the teacher and performer. And Executive Director Emily. Ms. Lisa? Yes. Thank you. But do you mind if you stay a bit? I think some of them may have more questions to ask you about. Haplos na mainit. We really want this space to be very interactive. Kasi often you don't have the likes of Lisa Makua, right? And when you can hold her, I only used to watch her. You were my first ballet show. Yes, I realized when I saw you, I could never be a ballerina. It required a certain physique. And my body is a wonderland, and so is yours. So we would like the others in the audience to have to throw in some questions. Now is the time. Hindi niyo po makakatabi every day sa aeroplano. Ma'am Lisa, pero kung gusto kayo, may kamera kayong questions on immigration forms. She may be able to give you some answers, but anyone? Actually, I want to know more about your pet project, PBF. I mean, how can more of us, how many young women are you mentoring right now?
Well, it started as a formal project in 2008, but it actually started as a project to teach male students in ballet, because there's always a demand for male ballet dancers. It started, my first students were the anak of our manicurista and our houseboy in Quezon City when I was still single. And I would give free ballet classes to these two male dancers in the porch in my home. Yes, and then the program actually became quite formal in 2008 when it was dubbed Project Ballet Futures. And we partnered with several organizations, schools, our first partner was PCF, the school that is made out of the recycled cargo containers in Smoky Mountain in Tondo. And that was why Jessa was one of the first scholars when it was formally dubbed Project Ballet Futures. We extended the ballet scholarship to include women, girls and boys. And now we just finished auditioning in 5 schools around the Pasay City area, and we've collected 31 boys and girls. 2 have already dropped out. That's how difficult the training is, yes.
Thank you. I think we have a couple more questions from it. Ballet is there. How many hours? They say that's about 10,000 hours before you can say that you actually have gained that memory, and the memory is really how many hours do you think do we need to be able to reach that moment in terms of repetition? Is there a required number of hours?
Unfortunately, to become a professional dancer, I think everyone in this room is too late. That's why you have to start early when you're at least 8, 9, 10 years old. I started when I was 9 years old, because you have to keep at it for more than just 10,000 hours, I think.
So I have to scratch out number 7 then and go back to decide a new career.
Yes.
I wanted to go to dancing, so I guess we scratch it out.
Professional. We can always dance just for ourselves, but people will not pay to watch our performance.
You never know. Okay, thank you very much, Ma'am Lisa. Do you have any shows or classes that people can...
Yes, actually, I'd like to invite everyone, if you want to be a part and you want to learn how to dance just for fun or physical fitness, it's actually been proven that it's the best form of therapy to prevent dementia. Dancing. Yeah, dancing is the best form of exercise because it works both sides of your brain. You do it to music, it's never boring. We have adult ballet in both Fisher Mall and Fisher Mall branch on the 4th level and in Pasay City, right there, yes, after office hours. We have our enrollment going on for our summer intensive, which begins April 3, also in both the Fisher Mall branch and the Donada City branch of Donada Street branch of Ballet Manila. The summer intensive will culminate in a performance on May 28, and that is incidentally the 20th anniversary of the Lisa Macuja School of Ballet Manila. So I'd like to invite everyone to come and enjoy the art of dance. And if you are free, we open our season in August with Ibong Adarna, the world premiere of Ibong Adarna. Swan Lake in October. In November, December, I choreograph my version of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. And in February 2018, we have Ballet and Ballads with Christian Bautista. So that's our 22nd performance season in Ballet Manila. We just closed our season actually 2 weeks ago with Don Quixote. Yeah, so right now we're in our creative period. Yeah.
Can you indulge us with a bit? I know everybody is cold, but in terms of women, inspiring women, you know, one of the most distinct indication of power or lack of power is how our bodies are shaped. Would you have any advice on what movements can we do? What movements can we do to assert power? You know, little things that we can change in our daily movements.
You know, I think first and foremost is posture. Yeah, we can all sit up straighter. We can all put our chin up. I like to tell my students to feel like you're making ipit a pencil between your shoulder blades. Oh. Yes, at the back. Suck in that stomach. Yes. I think there's nothing like good posture, and it's also healthy. It improves your circulation, and it just removes 10 years off your age. So that is something that all of you can do every day. Just put your shoulders back, lift your chin up. Imagine that there's a string pulling you up the ceiling through your back, and just stand tall. Stand tall, okay. Yes.
It creates warmth.
Yes. Yes, that's right. Okay, stand up. Yeah? And just imagine that there's a string from the base of your spine pulling yourself up through your spinal column, through your neck, all the way through the back of your head, up to the ceiling. Now roll your shoulders up and roll your shoulders down. Feel your long neck. Yes, that's right. Yeah. Now suck in that gut. Yes. Okay. Don't you feel better? Yeah? Yeah, okay. And when you feel better, there's nothing like feeling better to boost your confidence.
Thank you very much. Everyone, Lisa Macuja-Elizalde.